You're listening to Ka-Pow, the pop culture podcast, comics, television, movies, and more. If it impacts fan culture, we have something to say about it. And now, your hosts, Michael, Jordan, Cliff, and Seth.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back. Ka-Pow, the pop culture podcast, is back with it. My name is Jordan Lowe.
I'm Cliff Barnes.
I'm Seth. We're with it.
That's
pretty great.
How's everybody doing?
It's about time.
Feels like it's been a while.
Yeah. Yeah, it's been a month or so.
We had a week we didn't put an episode out. It felt weird.
Nobody seemed to care.
Nobody even noticed but us.
I didn't even know that, yes.
But hey, if you were letting them pile up, you got a chance to go through them all at your leisure.
And you're kicking yourself. You didn't take the chance.
All right.
Well, we are closing in on episode 300.
Oh, my God.
We are just a few away, so we have been busy prepping for that.
Mm.
If you've listened to any of our
other
Cliff's been involved. You're the only one not been involved.
Okay, right? Good. Yeah. Yeah, that's what I like.
You are our audience for this. If you've listened to episode 100 or 200, you probably know what's coming, but we've been having fun going back to some of our older episodes to find some gems.
Yeah, when Jordan sent me the initial list, and just reading like through his notes, I didn't even have to listen to anything.
Yeah, you knew it right
away. Yeah, I was cracking up. I was like, oh my gosh, I forgot about this. I forgot about that.
Should we tease a few?
Oh man.
Oh yeah, let me have it.
First one I had was door number 2 on 676. Do you remember that story?
I do. It took me a second.
What's up with T'Chaka's eye?
That was it. That was the one.
We talked about eyes going back a long time.
Yeah,
and we're still doing it.
That's our origin story, probably, for eyes.
Barbethel is a real wet blanket.
Oh.
It's very true.
She is, yes.
It is known.
Yeah.
The first origin. Yeah, there was some good stuff in there.
Yeah, that's exciting.
So not too much more of a wait for that. We'll be closing on that real soon. And we have a little housekeeping for our patrons. We still don't know what happened, but Cliff, why don't you explain what we think happened?
Yeah.
I don't want to think what looked like happened.
Right.
Because one day we had no more patrons. All our patrons left us.
And to show how much we pay attention to our money, we didn't notice it. And we had to have one of them point it out to us. But apparently back in early summer, we don't know why, but all of our patrons' subscription had been canceled. Not even on the same day, like the same month, but not the same day.
Weird.
We're still not sure why that happened or how it happened. I emailed Podbean about it, sent a support ticket in, got a response that they really couldn't tell anything had happened, and that our campaign or our crowdfunding is actually still active. They just don't know why it canceled everybody. So going forward here,
if it was something we did, we're sorry.
Yeah. But I'm pretty sure we didn't, because we never touch it. Like, yeah, we don't ever bother it. But going forward, we're going to have to make a decision on what we want to do with that. So if we're going to just continue it and see who, you know, ask everybody to resubscribe or repledge, to that same campaign, or if we want to do something, an alternative to that, that might be a little bit more, I don't want to say trustworthy, but, you know, something a little bit, maybe a little bit more established. So because, well, we don't want to tell Podbean, but, we're not even supposed to have crowdfunding at the level that we pay monthly. It's supposed to be a higher level subscription, that gets that perk.
But I hate when that happens. It's like when you're using somebody's account for something and they don't have it. Doesn't this happen to you, guys with Michael or something? It's like, hey, oh, I'm trying to use this. Why have you not re-upped your thing? The show's out today.
I don't know what you're talking about.
It's hard to complain.
I get all my streaming through legitimate means.
Yeah. but yeah, that's we may have apparently kind of slipped through a crack or been grandfathered in at some point, and I don't know, maybe some wires got crossed. I'm not exactly sure, but we're working on it. We'll let you guys know we'll let our patrons know on our Facebook patron page, I'm sure, when we figure exactly what we want to do with that. Or if we're not going to change it, maybe we'll just keep it the way it is. Who knows? So
we definitely appreciate all of our patrons, whether they pay us or not.
Yeah.
Whether we get their money or not.
Whatevs, man.
The intention was there.
Right. But it's been a little while since we've thrown an episode out there, but we actually all got together for a little bit of a field trip.
Ooh.
We jumped in the Cliffmobile and headed to Cleveland a couple weeks ago.
Yes.
That's the old Bull Yard.
Yes.
The Ball Yard.
The Ball Yard. And, yeah.
Take me out to the Ball Yard.
Yeah, I'm just like, this sounds like somebody that doesn't know sports. I don't know this.
Yeah, we loaded up in tow with, and you know, plus two low brothers and up to Progressive Field and caught
found another low brother over there.
Yeah, found
another. That was great. I was just like, I remember walking up there. I was like, oh, I think that's Justin. But I didn't even say anything because I was like, obviously, if I know that's him, and I don't even think I had ever met him in real life, and I recognized him from the back, and you guys just stood right beside him.
I was taking in the majesty of Progressive Field. Oh, well, I was overwhelmed.
I've been there. But then you start walking away. I was like, wait a second. He's right here.
Yeah, we hadn't been there not even 3 or 4 minutes. And yeah, very easy meet up there. So.
Well, it was not a huge throng of people.
That's true.
The attendance was a little smaller than normal. Yeah, it rained on us for a bit, but not terribly.
Yeah. I think I was the only one that brought a rain jacket.
You were. Definitely were. But it was a lot of fun. Not a lot of people showed up for this makeup game. So we kind of had,
Battle of Ohio.
Come yeah. On.
It was the perfect thing for us.
The Ohio Cup. Yeah, two Cleveland fans and three Reds fans. And even in the crowd, I would say it was probably close to 50-50 out of the few people that stuck around for it. Yeah, but people
made the drive over.
Yeah, yeah. So some of us were happier than others. Cleveland prevailed, I think, 9-2.
Something like that. It was pretty... Not close there at some point.
Not at all.
A little bit lopsided.
Yeah.
Yeah,
also, the closest I've ever been to a foul ball.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That was close.
We were in the front row of the upper deck, right behind home plate. And what's his name?
Jose Ramirez.
Jose Ramirez. Probably the biggest name on the team.
Yeah.
Fouls one straight back, and it keeps climbing and climbing. I was like, that's not going to get all the way up here, is it? No, and it banged. Jared was on the aisle, and it banged into the seat, the very next seat to him. But there's an aisle between his seat and that seat, so it was an arm's length away.
Yeah.
But there was a handrail between him and the ball, and a guy behind him, or behind where the ball landed, reached over and picked it up. He's like, if it would have bounced off the seat and dribbled forward, he wouldn't have been able to grab it. But it didn't. It just kind of died in the seat. So I've never even been in the same section as a foul ball. So I was, that was wow. very exciting.
Yeah, it was pretty neat. And we got to see some other people fight over a ball.
Yeah. Yeah, there was a struggle down below. But yeah, no, I thought it was a pretty fun night. We don't get to do that very often. We stopped and ate about halfway through. Had a Sandy Duncan situation going on at the restaurant, but the eyes just
That's
follow
a T'Chaka.
Us.
That's yeah. a T'Chaka. So. Anyway, it was good. I on a whim, I thought, hey, this feels like the perfect thing. It's our chance to get out before the pandemic's back. And we made it. We made it happen. We worked it out.
That's right.
So that was good.
After over a year of being kind of cooped up, it was nice to go out and do something in the out of doors at the old ball yard.
Man, I remember that. Oh, take me out to the ball yard.
And then soon after that, I had the free comic book day at the old store shop. So we talked about that in a previous episode of all the fun books that were coming out. So we had a pretty good day. The number of attendees were down compared to previous years, which is kind of what I expected. Didn't have any kind of record crowd or anything, which, you know, nobody's doing that this year, I don't think. But
right. Well, also it was in August.
Yeah, so it was pushed from its normal date, so it's a little bit, you know, a lot of variables there. But sales were pretty good. Collected a pretty good amount for the Tri-County Food Pantry. We had 8 tables of local artists there. They all seemed to have a good time. Michael was there, debuted Insecticid #1. It arrived the day before. It arrived on Friday, so he was able to.
Like,
he was
I'm
able
surprised
to
it didn't arrive on Saturday.
Right.
That.
Yeah.
That sounds just right.
So yeah, that was at the SoPro Comics booth there. You can find more on that at soprocomics.com. I believe you can order straight from there. Maybe even a variant cover. We got some variant covers on there. We're all excited about.
I've been sitting there. I want to interrupt. I was like, I want to apologize to Justin. I had met him before. No. I was sitting there thinking, I don't want to say that if I have met him. I did meet him at the festival thing you did. He came down, was working the table loft. Where was that? Was that the Lafayette?
Anyone you've been to, he's been there, I'm sure.
Okay, yeah. The last one.
Oh, yeah. I do remember that because I think
he was sitting at the
front.
So you, yeah. Okay. Sorry, Justin. We had met.
But he came down for free comic book day too, so he was there. Everybody was there helping out. The only negative, if you remember me describing this poster, sponsored my presenting sponsor, Coca-Cola, is going to give us this poster with augmented reality. You scan a QR code and you've got an art gallery and a prize wheel and all this wonderful stuff. Well, as of Friday afternoon, I still had not received the poster. So I texted a couple of retail acquaintances of mine, and the guy in Parkersburg had not got it either. But a guy I know in Columbus had. So some retailers got it, some didn't. Mine ended up showing up Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
Free comic day was a Saturday. It showed up 3 days later on a Tuesday.
Nice.
But it said I believe I was not an isolated case because they said, we're going to leave the code active for the next week. If any shops want to leave the poster up, people can still get those prizes. So I thought, all right, well, so I put the poster up. And then I read an article that said, like, even the shops that got the poster, they were having technical problems with it.
It didn't work.
When you scanned it, it like sent you to the comic shop locator service and didn't do all the stuff it's supposed to do. And then they were like, you know, they had to fix it the day it came out, and it was a real problem. But, and also apparently Coke didn't do any sort of advertising they didn't even send a tweet out that said, you know, go to a shop and check out our poster. Like, they didn't. That was the only thing they did, was these posters. So I thought, you know, having this big sponsor, they've got quite a reach. They've got, you know, Instagrams and Facebooks and Twitters that, you know, they've got millions of people they could reach this out to. And that was not part of the deal, I guess. Asking for a tweet or two was a little bit beyond them. So a faulty poster and no help from our corporate overlords. So thanks. Thanks, guys.
That's great.
The comic industry does it on our own, I guess. So, yeah, let's talk about movies.
All right.
I'm out of segues. It's been too long.
Save Martha!
Puny god.
I'm just a kid from Brooklyn.
I'm Batman.
Kneel before Zod!
Under Ruth!
Set it yourself, bitch. We're the guardians of the galaxy.
So what's it gonna be, huh? Long sullen silence or mean comment? Go on.
You got me in a box here.
Well, it's been a while, so I'm sure we've got a few to that we've all watched, more or less. We had the big, you know, I think even when we went to Cleveland, I think we'd already seen the Suicide Squad.
That "the" is very important.
Yeah.
Supervillains. Sad souls in costumes, wanting you to think they're all dark and deep. What's it like? Live your life as a punchline. But all it would take would be one blessed act of rebellion for you to restore your dignity in its entirety.
You know the deal. Complete the mission, you get 10 years off your sentence. You fail to follow my orders in any way, and I detonate the explosive device in the base of your skull.
Love them or hate them, these are your brothers and sisters for the next few days.
Any questions?
Hand?
Yes, that is your hand. Very good.
We're all gonna die.
I hope so.
Oh, for God's sake.
Came out in theaters and HBO Max on the same day. So that was really nice. I was pretty excited about it. You know, I had faith in James Gunn, and I was one of those folks that I really enjoyed it. I thought, you know, it was ultra violent and silly most of the time, but I thought it was a lot of fun. It felt very, you know, it just felt like I was watching a comic book to me. You know, I've read a little bit of Suicide Squad here and there, and that's just the way it is. There's a mission. You have a ragtag cast of characters that sometimes don't always make it. And it's just meant to be a lot of fun. So I highly enjoyed it.
I'm a little torn that I definitely liked it better than the first one.
Yeah.
And it had some real enjoyable moments and some good characters, but something about it didn't quite click with me. And I'm not quite sure what it was.
This is a complaint about a lot of movies, but it was so gray. I'm just so sick of this gray looking movies. You know, I mean, there was color in it, but just like everything's so gray and nothing wants to be vibrant anymore. You know, it's very annoying.
Yeah. There were definitely some, you know, even the costumes, some a lot more than others. You know, we had a very colorful polka dot man. We had a very colorful, giant starfish. And of course Harley and everything, and she looked pretty comic accurate.
Yeah.
But then you had, you know, the Idris Elba character was kind of blah on the costume.
It was a blood sport, right?
Blood sport. Yeah.
I don't know all these DC characters, but I have a complaint about him, yeah. But I
Peacemaker looked great.
Yeah, he was great. That's what that guy should be doing. Like, yeah. Quit trying to. Don't ever try to make him do a serious.
No, definitely.
This
not.
He was. That is exactly the type of character Cena should play. I really liked the movie. It's one of the better DC movies I think I've ever seen. Like, I mean, I know what the Suicide Squad is. I don't. Obviously, you know, some of these characters aren't even remotely what they are in the comics anyway, but
right,
but
and some of them it didn't matter because they
it doesn't
were
matter that's the whole
minutes.
Point it's the whole point they're supposed yeah. to be this they're disposable throwaways. Thing I thought it was really good. I enjoyed it I mean I don't know it doesn't get some big rating from me or anything, but it's what I was way better than I was expecting after seeing the first one. And I there was a lot to like about it.
Yeah. The only real complaint I had was that Bloodsport character. I felt like to me, they really wrote Will Smith into the movie and then Will Smith wasn't in the movie and they just kind of threw another guy in there.
Yeah.
I'm not convinced the casual fan will even know he's supposed to be a different character.
That's true.
Yeah.
It's a guy with guns and a daughter that he's got problems with. Like, that was Deadshot's whole thing in the first movie. It was a young daughter he's trying to, you know, impress. So I guess it's a little different because he's kind of estranged from her. But
I
rewatched the first one just a couple days. I don't think I'd seen the first one since it came out.
Yeah,
I rewatched it. It was rough, but I forgot all the music in the first one and how ridiculous it was. There are like 75 like pop songs they just throw out at random times. I forgot about the Harley scene with the swing, bada 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 swing. If you remember that song from the '90s, like holy.
Is them trying to do what James Gunn?
Yeah. So yes. James Gunn is much better at that with his 70s soft rock and stuff. So definitely the soundtrack was better on this one. And even these throwaway characters had a lot more personality than even the main characters in the first one.
Yeah.
So what James Gunn did, I think what they wanted him to do.
Oh, I know what I really liked. I loved the transitions where they had the stuff written in the the topography, you know, whatever in the background. I love all that stuff. I thought that was seamless and really perfectly matched the movie, the level of, you know, how serious you're supposed to take it. And just like, it was just well done. All that stuff was,
it was
very
really
creative
good.
And, you know, just made it a little comic booky. And I love that.
Yeah.
My biggest complaint, and this isn't about this movie, this isn't totally original. I've heard other people complain over time and I've always agreed with this. I do not like nanotechnology.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sick of it. It has the opposite effect of
it's
what
like magic it can do.
Yes.
Anything you need to do.
But there's two things about it. One, he's the only one, like in this movie, Bloodsport's the only one that has it. His just what his gun just changes into every flipping whatever he wants. And first off, that makes no sense. That entire world would be different if this technology existed. The world he was in did not have nanotechnology, just him.
Do you know how many boomerangs boomerang could have?
Exactly. It just, I hate it. It doesn't look as cool as they think it does. And two, it would have been 100 times cooler if he just freaking started pulling attachments off of himself, changing his gun a million different ways.
Yeah.
You know, you know, for real, you know, whatever, I can't think of a word, you know, just actually do it, you know, and with a, you know, just a lot of cool snapping stuff on, changing it for whatever purpose, not this Iron Man crap where stuff. I don't like nanotechnology.
And it did stand out because it was just him.
It was just, I mean, I know certain people have certain you know, these are heroes with their own technology and stuff, but that's not what that guy should be having. It should just be, he's good with guns. He's got a bunch of attachments. Don't do this stupid thing that creates a technology.
And that may have...
That other people should have too, you know.
That may have been an effort into trying to say, this isn't Will Smith. This is, you know, that's what he did. Whatever.
It's a minor thing as far as, I mean, they're all these movies do it now. It's just like the evolution of comic books went there. You know, eventually it's just Tony Stark had to have.
The way no one wears a real mask anymore or helmet, it just shows up.
It just pops up.
Because they don't want the actors pulling them on and off. So
I hate it.
Everything just magically appears on your face.
I know why they do it, and they're not going to stop doing it, but it's never going to make me happy.
But character-wise, I thought the story was fun. I love Starro. Even though I knew Starro was going to be in it, love Starro.
I swear to you, I did not do this as a joke because I wrote these notes when I watched the movie weeks ago. In my notes, I have Starro's eyes are weird. We're obsessed with eyes. But it had kind of like weird googly eyes or something. Something about it looked off to me. I don't know. I mean, a giant foam starfish is going to look silly anyway, but something about his eyes did.
And I liked that, I guess, the character that, like, what was the last thing he says? I mean, I assume everybody's seen this by now. But just the fact I was perfectly happy. You know, I was happy just laying there looking at the stars or whatever. Or something. Yeah. He says something like that. It's just like, that was good. It was good. You know, it's like, you guys did this to me. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. Excellent. You know, I mentioned, you know, John Cena playing Peacemaker. I thought that character was great for this movie. There's been all, you know, even before the movie came out, about Polka Dot Man was a standout in this. And I thought he was really good. I loved
that character.
And
that was cool.
The surprising out of all of them, Ratcatcher 2, and then having Taika Waititi as Ratcatcher. Her father, but they took this, you know, they really made something out of that character. I highly enjoyed it. And I was like, man, I hope if they do another one of these, I hope she's the villain. Like, that would be awesome. For such a silly character, but
yeah, she was definitely my favorite of the bunch. I loved her.
She was being serious. She's one of the only people that was like a serious role, you know,
but like the mask that, you know, looked like the, what do you call that? Like fumigator or whatever.
Yes,
like that.
Tried to think of the word the other day. Yeah. That's good.
But yeah, the costume work, I thought the actress was really good and like pulled off, you know, one of the few characters that was actually trying to be a hero. I think Margot Robbie, I think, was born to play Harley. Now that they figured out who Harley is in these movies, she is perfect, where she's not just the Joker's girl, that kind of deal. Like, she has her own kind of thing going on. I thought the Milton gag was one of the funniest things I've seen in movies in a long time. Of like, because I was like, why is that guy still? Because I had thought that, like, that guy in flip flops is still just following them around, and they start arguing over it. Has Milton been here the whole time? So, there's a lot of stuff that worked. I don't know. They did the same thing the first movie did with the villains, or the infected people, like, they're already dead. When Starro gets on your face, you're dead. So they can just mow you down, and there's no moral grit. So in the first movie, everyone had their weird, like, bubble creatures or whatever. They had been infected by the ancient evil gods or whatever. So they just mow them down. Like, I would prefer a little more, like, you know, do we save these people? Do we kill these people? You know, a little bit of moral gray area would be nice.
The best scene, though, to me was murdering the entire village of good people, and then find just stab, just like all these people. They're like, oh, these were the good guys. That was good.
Yeah, they excellent job. You know, I still laugh no matter what medium it is. No matter, you know, cartoon, movie, live action show. I still love what they do with King Shark. He's just, I mean, in all of it, it's just, no matter what version it is, I'm always like, that is great. I loved what Ron Funches did with him in the Harley cartoon, and that character has been featured on the Flash TV show a few times, and then, you know, here we are again. I was just like, and it was very similar in a lot of ways to the Harley cartoon show, but you know, having Sylvester Stallone do that voice was just, it was great. I so happy with this movie. I need to go back and watch it again because I really did enjoy it. I watched it kind of late at night with my kids, and it just, at the that first viewing, felt very long. Like it was never going to end a little bit, but yeah, overall great. So
it's on HBO through September 5th, so you still have a little bit of time to watch it. And they had a little, speaking of King Shark, they had a little behind the scenes, like a little 2-minute thing I watched of costumes or whatever, a couple of little behind the scenes featurettes. And on set, the stand in for King Shark was Steve Agee, the comedian. Mm-hmm. He played the guy in the control room, the computer guy. So he was the stand in. And there was just one little shot of him standing there wearing like this big foam thing to make him look, you know, bigger. And it looked almost like a life jacket with a fin on the back. So he's a real big guy, tall guy anyway. So him just standing there in this big puffy, like shark abdomen, like it was really funny to see the behind the scenes of it all. And in the credits, I was reading the credits, and they credited a couple of the rats that were not CGI. And her rat Sebastian was played by a rat named Crisp, C-R-I-S-P, Rat. So it was played by Crisp Rat.
Oh, my God. That's funny. Well, yep. I think it was a success. It's pretty disposable to me. I probably will never watch it again, but I did think it was good. That was a good DC movie.
We're going to have to save that for the archives because Seth doesn't say that very
often. No. I know. Hey, I'm being honest. I'll tell you if I like it. It was no Zack Snyder thing. It's no surprise to me that I liked the James Gunn DC movie. So what do we got now? Anybody see anything else? I don't know. I'll have to look here. I'm unprepared.
The other HBO premiere was that Reminiscence.
Oh, I haven't watched it yet.
Okay, that was the... Hugh Jackman, Rebecca Ferguson, Tandy Newton, Cliff Curtis.
Yeah,
sure. I hadn't heard of this movie, and it just kind of popped up on HBO one day as I was browsing through, and I thought, wow, do I want to watch this movie? I like Hugh Jackman.
It's looks... Crisp Rat and Hugh Jackman.
But then
I like Rebecca Ferguson, so I do want to watch.
And well, I stopped and the reviews weren't very, from what I, the reviews I kind of, the headlines.
Yeah,
I,
they didn't.
It was kind of trash. So I didn't watch it. So.
Well, this is the feature debut from Lisa Joy, who's a co-creator of Westworld. So she wrote, this is the first film she wrote and directed. And there's definitely a Westworld vibe about, you know, cause it's about, there's, the future has this technology that you can go back and capture people's memories. You can get into their heads and it kind of projects them, and you can see. So it's used as, you know, the police can go in and interrogate you, or people can pay money to remember a lost love that they had as a child and that kind of thing. So that's the conceit. So it's, you can already tell it has a Westworld sort of memories and reality and past and future and that kind of stuff. So it throws that into kind of a noir detective story. Rebecca Ferguson, is she the damsel in distress, or is she the femme fatale, or is she, you know, it's Hugh Jackman's kind of trying to solve her story. So I liked it. It's not the best thing I saw this year, but it had a good sense of place and really good world building in the settings and stuff in this near future, because sometimes that stuff's a little bit sloppy, but you expect the person in charge of Westworld to think about what the near future would actually look like, and I think it did a really good job at that.
Yeah, I want to check it out. I did watch a movie this month on Apple TV Plus or whatever, called CODA. I get a feeling that I never
the girl with the deaf family?
Yeah.
I just want to tell you right now.
And you sing. Interesting.
Something's got a hold on me, yeah.
What are you doing next year?
Working with my family.
Let me tell you now, I've got a feeling. I feel so strange. Everything about me seems to have changed.
I've been coaching for Berklee College of Music. I can help you get a scholarship.
And I had seen, I put it on my watch list a couple months ago. At some point, there was a film festival or something this year that it got a bunch of buzz, and Apple bought it for their channel. And you know, it has Emilia Jones, who played Kinsey in the Lock and Key season one, and just like a newer actress. And CODA stands for Child of Death. Of deaf adults, I believe. Yeah, deaf adults. She's a her in the. Oh, and Marley Matlin plays her mom. Anyway, the whole her father and mother and brother are all deaf, and she is hearing. So it's just the struggles involved in that. And like I said, it got a lot of buzz. Like, people really love this movie. And I mean, I don't know that you could watch it. I'm sure there are people. I will cry at anything if it pull enough at my heartstrings and stuff. But I you know, of course, teared up at the parts that they want you to. And it was fine acting, and it was a decent movie. But it was so, it was like watching the Hallmark Channel, as far as I really don't get the buzz, because it was so cliche, the whole thing. Everything that you thought was going to happen, happened. The tryout for her to get to go off on her own. She's got a tryout because, oh, she can sing and they can't hear. And it's just like, there's... You want them going to watch her sing, and they can't, don't, they're just watching other people react to it. And that's neat. I get it. But it's like, you want there, it's an obvious thing that could be solved right in this moment that they're not doing. And they wait till the end of the movie to do it. And everything is so cliche, from music teacher to helping her to her boyfriend, everything. And I was just like, it was just like cookie cutter Hallmark movie, and it annoyed me.
Did you ever go back and watch on Apple Plus that Palmer Justin Timberlake?
It's on my watch list, but no, I haven't watched.
Okay,
it.
I watched it, has that. To be better. Yeah, probably, but I mean, it was good. But it now that you say that, yeah, it was kind of.
Oh, was it? Okay, because that's. I mean, I was enjoying CODA as I watched it. But as it went on, I was like, man, everything that should happen is happening, and it got all the way to the end. And I'm like, okay, you did it. You made everybody cry, but it wasn't anything special. So, it's fine.
Okay. Yeah.
That's all the movies I think I've watched. It's still.
I got one more thing. I took notes on this a little while back, but our recent episodes have been pretty packed. So, but this is important to me, so I'm going to get out there. This is just a little vindication for me. Esquire magazine did a profile of Kevin Bacon a few months back, and one of the questions was, "Are there any roles he'd be interested in going back to revisit?"
Oh Lord!
And he said, says he likes to leave the past in the past. You know, he doesn't think back on that. And then he stopped and corrected himself.
We know where this is going.
Tremors. It was one film, quote, "It was one film of mine that I wanted to revisit that character. I don't look back at all. In fact, Tremors is the only movie of mine that I've rewatched since it came out. We were around the 25-year anniversary. I went to Blumhouse, and they were totally into the idea. Universal didn't want to remake it as a feature, And also maybe because it didn't work as a feature the first time. So we put it aside. Then they came back to me and said, what would you think about doing it as a series? The series was shopped around and eventually they ended at sci-fi and then died before making it to air. I would still love to do it, believe me. Maybe it needs to be the 30th anniversary or the 35th, but we'll keep going.
You know what?
Kevin Bacon's
like,
out there standing for all
what I like about that. I thought for a second I was gonna say with that where it was going, but I thought he was. Usually, when an actor says something like that, they're just advertising. They're just promoting something. But the fact that it did get canceled, and he's just saying he just has a love for it. I like that. Like that's a true that he actually feels that way about
it. And how many actors have you heard? Oh, I don't watch anything. I mean, I can't stand to watch myself. That
right.
Kind of
yes.
So that's a standard thing. But I've heard him in interviews before talk about like he'll walk into the room and his kids are watching Tremors or something. Like, so it definitely has some place with his and his nostalgia.
Yeah. Cool. That's cool. Maybe something will happen.
Thanks.
Oh,
my Echo said thanks. I don't know why.
All right. So before we wrap this one up, we could do a segment we haven't done in a little bit. Yeah, you know me.
You down with KPP?
Yeah, you know me.
What the hell is wrong with you people?
You know me.
What's wrong with you? What is wrong with you?
You know me.
I hate so much about the things that you choose to be.
You know me.
You don't know.
Why are you the way that you are?
Question mark.
So what do you got? What do you want to know about us, Jordan? And yourself.
I had a couple to choose from. I just went to the insurance agent this morning and paid my insurance bill. So that got me thinking about, casualties, that sort of thing. So, hey, if something happened, like your house caught fire, there's some kind of natural calamity, what would be the one thing you would save out of your house? You just had time to grab one thing, maybe two small. You got a left hand or right hand?
Oh,
maybe
you
grab two small things or whatever you can carry. What's the one thing? And we're not talking children or pets.
Yeah,
or,
yeah.
What one inanimate object would you save?
Now, are you taking into account how hard it would be to get at said thing, like think in your house where it is.
You're just smelling smoke. You have a little time.
No, I don't want that. I want it realistic. I want you to put yourself in the situation. Blazing fire. None of this smoke. What can you realistically
I would
get
run
to?
Like George Costanza and not do it. I wouldn't do it. I would knock anyone out of the way. Wouldn't grab anything.
Right. I'd grab, just grab the eclair off the top of the trash and I'm out of there. Well, I'm just like trying to put myself in the moment. What could I actually get to? I'm really, because if you have any more time than that, you can grab more than one or two things.
Right,
put yourself in that.
Yeah. And you know, the cliche answer everybody always says, well, I'd grab the family picture album. You can't replace those. I think we need to disqualify that answer because I hear that. I've heard that question.
Yeah,
and I've heard that answer.
Cliff would grab an armful of Ewoks and just.
Yes.
Yeah. Right now, after all the money he spent on Ewoks, he'd like, I'd get that stick that I paid $45
That's
for.
Right. That little teeny tiny piece of plastic.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
Oh man, a melted puddle of Ewoks would be the biggest tragedy of the whole fire.
It's so sad. I don't even want to think about it.
I don't want to think. I've thought about if everything burnt down. It's like I'm not gonna be able to. All of these Omnis I've been buying, all these games behind me. Oh my gosh, all this stuff.
I have definitely had that thought. Right to my left here is a window. I'm kind of on a
I would take this
he's
window.
He's chucking stuff out the window.
But yeah, these long boxes. I'm like, how many of these long boxes could I, you know, careen out the window? And they, it's not quite a second story, so it wouldn't be a huge drop. They'd probably still be in good conditions.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've got a short box of like autographed comics that would be irreplaceable. You know, all the conventions I've gone to or celebrities I've met. So that would be pretty much the top of my list because like, you just couldn't ever get those again. But it's still just it's just objects. I don't know. But I don't have a ton. I'm a renter. I'm in an apartment, so I don't have a ton of heirlooms or anything. So yeah, there's no silverware or any you know. Fancy
jewelry. I've got to get the forks.
Yeah. That's actually that's actually probably it for me though. I have
Ewoks?
No. I have two stainless steel thick kettles that belong to my grandmother. Mm. And she used those all the time.
I just tried to picture just for a second. Cliff, there's a fire. He runs out, grabs two kettles,
yes.
runs out of the house. You're standing in the yard with kettles. I better see when I look out the door. You holding two kettles.
Yeah, but that you know,
if you can fill them with water, you can help fight the fire.
Right? See,
they're utilitarian.
Exactly, dual purpose. but those, you know, the one especially that was like what she used. That's what she used. She made, you know, she was famous for pies and mashed potatoes, I swear. But the cream tomatoes, the homemade mashed potatoes that we have all these family memories of, that will, it's just something that can't be duplicated. And she always made it a point from when, gosh, even when I was a kid, that when the day came, those were to go to me. That's really kind of all I have. Like when we went through their house, when my grandparents went through their house, after they'd passed away, like everybody got something. And there was a lot of stuff and I just kind of let everybody else take what they wanted. And because I knew what I knew that one thing. So that would be probably, you know, I don't know how much damage fire could do to that, but that would probably be, you know, on the short list.
Oh, I get it.
Other than that, I'm not real sure. Everybody, like I said, everybody kind of says, oh, the family pictures or, you know, grab the safe or whatever. But I'm looking right to my left. I'm like, what do I got in this room right here? Like, what's you know.
You got your all the controls I see there, and your you're sitting in the cockpit of an X-wing right now, or is that an X-wing?
Yeah, it's an X-wing.
It looks a little less cramped than a snow speeder. I was trying to figure
right,
out.
Right, right. Yeah.
I just remember these bad boys are in my house as well.
Oh, VHS copy, Star Wars trilogy.
Yeah,
non-special edition.
Oh, you grab those, and I'll grab my VCR.
Yeah.
My grandma's VCR.
Yeah.
She left me.
The other thing, the other thing I have, like right next to me, I have like, the Atari 2600 sitting here.
I'm just trying to picture this.
Yeah.
And in the fire. Here I go. Where's the 2600?
Where's the Atari?
I need the cable. I'll never find the cable for this.
I've got to unscrew the cable from the back of the TV.
I need a damn RF adapter.
But it's the only, you know, that was the one, that was my childhood one right there. A lot of toys and stuff I got rid of. You know, they would all became yard sale fodder. But for whatever reason, we kept the Atari. And it still works. Every great once in a while, we dust it off and plug it in. But I got a stack of games here. The last big time we really hooked it up was when my grandmother passed away. Whole family, we had the funeral and we were like, what are we going to do afterwards? We were going to go over to my parents, the whole family, you know, the immediate family. And, we had all this food and stuff, but it was like, what are we going to do? We got all the, we kind of, you kind of feel obligated to entertain a little bit. So I went up into the closet, into the closet and dug, you know, the box with the Atari out, not knowing if it still worked or not. Took it over to my parents. We figured out how to hook it back up to the modern big screen TV. And, I sat there with a bunch of my cousins and all of our kids. And I mean, we just, it was one of the best, you know, not, it sucked, but we made, you know, but lemons out of lemonade and had a blast with this thing.
Oh, heck just yeah.
Just like you do when these things happen. So,
well, I think maybe, if you made that. Yeah, I think maybe if you made it out with them kettles or that Atari, I think you'd be satisfied. You'd look back later and think, I have this. And this is a this is connected to a memory, or I knew it meant something to somebody, you know, someone before me. And, you know, you will feel like you've escaped with something. Well, I, as far as me, I mean, anyone that knows or has ever heard any of my stories about genealogy would know that I am very lucky to have several heirlooms that I, you know, I would absolutely would be what I would be grabbing on the way out. I, you know, I, it's ridiculous, but you know what I have, but I was trying to think where, you know, it would not be as easy to get to, but one of the things, but like, but quickly, my, I've worked diligently doing genealogy about over a decade ago, worked really hard, and that doesn't equal, should not equal the windfall of stuff I found. I just happened to be lucky to have had these stuff, these things existed. I don't think I'm some master genealogist, but I got lucky that these things were out there, and I was able to acquire my great, great grandfather's Civil War rifle. It took a decade to get that from where it was, but I did get that. And I have his Civil War papers, you know, that, you know, from the Ohio 100 that joined the Civil War and stuff. I have that and his enlistment paper framed on my wall. And these are the things I would grab. Realistically, I probably, if it was a blazing fire, I wouldn't be able to get the rifle, but right by my door, walking out the door, they are there for a reason. By the door are the Civil War papers and his pocket watch that his wife bought for him on Christmas Eve, 1888. You know, that would be coming with me. So if I made it out the door with at least that watch, I would be satisfied.
Do you still have that published online when you put all that together?
I think the link's broken. The link is broken. Okay. But I'm proud of that story, and I should try to fix that. If anybody ever wanted to read that, I'm pretty proud of having, you know, of that. I'm glad it exists. It's a once in a lifetime thing that happened to me, and I was able to, you know, I got it, spit it out there in a couple weeks. And Jordan, of course, the perennial editor, you know, got my story straight, got me to fix all my punctuation and everything, and made it legible. So I like the finished product. I honestly want to like get it in like a soft cover or something. Mm-hmm. I just have it printed out, or I can print it out. But I'd like to fix that link, and then maybe we'll post it, and people can get a chance to read it again or something. For the first time, but it's pretty exciting for me. So yeah, I liked your question, because I definitely have an answer for what I would grab out the door.
Yeah.
I should not have gone last then. That was, but yeah, I rent a place, anything with any heirloom or family thing is still at my mom's house. So there's nothing here. I moved so often. I don't, you know, I live pretty spartanly, so I don't have any big picture albums or any heirlooms like that. But so, yeah, I probably would have said the thumb drive with all my writing on it.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
because that, you know, if I lost, but that's all backed up. I've got that. I've got a copy at the store and a copy here. So I try to keep that updated on the having a backup on that. So yeah. But yeah, my first thought would have probably been, yeah, my laptop and a thumb drive to make sure I didn't lose the writing I've done for a decade. But I don't have a better answer than my autographed comics, because it's, again, they're just, it's not the value of them, but it is. I flip through them and remember every show I went to. Mm. Oh, that guy was really nice. Oh, I met Joe Kubert. His handshake was really firm. Like, I have all these memories that they're associated with. So yeah, the value, I'm never going to sell them. But it is, you know, dozens and dozens of books from all these shows I've gone to over the years. It's like a nice reminder of the how important comics have been to me over these years. So I think I'd grab a short box. Yeah, big surprise, comic book guy.
Hey, that is a lot of. I mean, these are attached to memories that will spark your memories as you look at them and stuff. So I definitely those kind of things are just under the heirlooms for me. You know, I'm like, what would I grab in that situation? You know, what could I, all those kind of possessions that I, it's so, I, the whole thought like scares the crap out of me, because there's so many things, even if insurance covered the things you've collected, you'd never be able to.
It's not a monetary thing. Yeah.
Yeah. It's such, so hard. Whenever I hear a girl I work with, her home burnt down a couple months ago, and it was like, and they didn't make it out with much, and one of my best friends, their home had burnt down, I was just like, man, that is devastating. You just lose everything.
Well, we're fortunate enough in today's world that we do, you know, that traditional, well, I'd grab the family Bible, I'd grab the photo albums. We're fortunate enough that, like, the photos now are backed up. You know, they're in the cloud. They're digital. They're on Facebook, whatever. So we're fortunate.
Facebook is honestly where if people really want to find pictures of their lives, go on there. Your family has put them on there.
Right. So we've progressed enough, kind of almost past that, at least for recent years. You know, I've got a box here of photographs from my grandparents and my great grandparents. Going back into the 19th century, you know, when photos were brand new, and a lot of it, though, it's like, we don't know who these people are anymore, you know, that are in these photographs, or it's, you know, I don't know whose farm this was. I don't know whose horse this was. You know, it's a lot of that, but we can't throw them away, but we don't really have any, relation to it.
I totally get that. I mean, everybody deals with that. You get these pictures you just don't know.
Yeah.
That's why I always loved looking, when I would look through old boxes of pictures and stuff when I was doing that. And I never may have met one of these people who had the pictures, but just the fact that they were one of the people that wrote on the back of the pictures who was in the picture, I was like, I love you.
Yeah.
You know, that is just, whoever wrote that on there and said from left to right, da 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 da, man, that is the stuff.
Yeah. And let me tell you, from the ones I have, most of them aren't that way. Like, it's unfortunate. So,
But
again, a problem that will never exist in the future.
Right.
No.
They will be tagged and archived. You'll know exactly the minute it was taken, where and with who.
It's crazy. Yeah. Anyone has to, it's a totally different world there. So, but anyway, since it doesn't come up a lot, I will tell anyone, if you have any interest in those times that didn't have all these Facebook timestamps and anything, if you want to go back and look at your family stuff, do it sooner than later. The sooner you do it while anyone is still alive to ask questions, that is the best advice I can give you. Don't put it off, because people that know things are going to be gone.
Yep.
Oh, and to wrap this into a little bow, Seth, the photo you took of the three Lowe brothers at the game.
Yes.
I emailed that to my mom, and she emailed back and said, thanks, I'm crying at work. So that photo,
it was just in that moment, I thought, I don't know that these guys are together all that much. And then anybody said, I was like, go stand over there.
So the power of the power of photographs can't be understated.
Yes, it is. It totally is. That makes me feel really good. I'm glad that it was a good pick. I snapped a few. I was like, "Ooh, this is the best one." And I love that we're so lucky that the technology is like, I could take that picture and send it to you guys immediately. So
yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah. What do they say now? Out of all the photographs ever taken, 10% were taken in the history of photographs. 10% were taken today, today. Because that's how many photographs we take now, because it's so easy.
Yeah, that's
hilarious. You couldn't, you got a roll of film. You can't waste it. You could only take
that was,
you only had 24 shots.
My friends had a photo store, his parents, my whole growing up. And just like, this was an art, it's like people were obsessed with that, and pictures, every picture mattered, and now it's so disposable.
Yes, it is. It was really something, even with home movies and stuff, because that film was so expensive. You only had that limited amount that, and a lot of, if you watch even the old home movies now, a lot of them, it's just 2 seconds of this, 2 seconds of that. And we're moving, they couldn't take the time to really capture a lot sometimes.
They were built for TikTok, I guess.
Yeah, that's for sure. That would be a neat thing. 8mm
TikTok.
Yeah. So.
Well, I'm glad you asked that question, Jordan. That was a good conversation. I enjoyed that. Hey, you got to know us.
Yeah, you know us. All right, that'll do it for this episode, everybody. So we will be back shortly with some more pop culture talk on the road to episode 300. Everybody go check the batteries in your smoke detector and be safe out there. My name is Jordan Lowe.
Red 5 checking out.
This is fine. Bye forever. Well, I'm going to give you the bad news first. I've totally been too preoccupied to watch Riverdale.
Ka-Pow, the pop culture podcast, is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Sounds, music, and clips played during the podcast are property of copyright holders. All original content is property of www.udamwithkpp.com. If you enjoyed this podcast, please subscribe and leave a comment. Ka-Pow, the pop culture podcast, is available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Podbean, Spotify, and wherever podcasts can be found. You can connect with us through social media on Facebook, YouTube, at the Ka-Pow Podcast on Twitter, or email the show, Ka-Pow, the pop culture podcast, @gmail.com. If you really want to go the extra mile, please sign up to be a patron through the Podbean app or our website, www.udamwithkpp.com, to receive special content and early access to some episodes. We are grateful to anyone that chooses to contribute, but please know that most of our content will always remain free, so please continue to like, comment, and share.